Well, we thank God for our devotion this morning. It was a powerful time in God's presence with Dr. George. And now we have for us another powerful man of God, another doctor, Dr. Dale Devines. Dr. Dale Devines is the founder and senior pastor of the Pillars of Truth Evangelistic Ministry in Chaguanas, Trinidad and Tobago. He is married to the beautiful Reverend Dawn Devines, and they have two wonderful children. He holds a lot of accolades, but some of them are Certified Mediation Officer, International Chaplain under the banner of the United Nations, Prison Chaplain with the Trinidad and Tobago Prison Services. He is a motivational speaker. He is a religious instruction teacher. He's a Bible school lecturer. He's a member of the Chaguanas Interreligious Committee under his worship, the mayor. And he's an apostle and overseer of several churches in Trinidad and Tobago, Jamaica, and St. Lucia. President of the Early Childhood Center Preschool in Longdonville, Chaguanas. He is a board member of AIM, of the Association of Independent Ministers. We have before us today a very powerful man of God, and we are just going to thank God and listen to what the Word of God is going to be coming through this servant of God to us this afternoon. Let's welcome Apostle Dr. Dale Devines.
Good day. Greetings in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This is Apostle Devines, and we continue to give God praise and glory for all that He has done and that He is continuing to do in our lives. This is Pentecost Rally 2022. And so far, we have heard from some mighty men of God, words of encouragement to the body of Christ. Today, I want to continue on the same topic, building together, Nehemiah 4 and verse 6. I pray, God, that you are listening wherever you are and that you are taking notes, because God is speaking to the body of Christ at this time. In Nehemiah 4 and verse 6, the team building together speaks well for those whose mindset is about kingdom advancement. According to the passage, when Sambalat and Tobias heard that Nehemiah had intentions to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem, the Bible says they laughed and they mocked the Jews. They had nothing good to say because they thought to themselves this was an impossible task for the people of God. But may I submit to us here today, what is impossible with men is indeed possible with Almighty God. The Bible tells us that no weapon formed against the church is going to prosper. God is with us. In Ephesians chapter 3 and verses 20, the Bible says, God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all we can think or imagine. Child of God, God can do, God can undo, God can overdo, God can extra do, God can mega do anything beyond human comprehension. Jesus made it very clear when he said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. As we set out to build together as spiritual institutions, we need to be very vigilant and to guard against a few things. And I want to share with you those few things we need to guard against as we continue this Pentecost Rally 2022. Number one, we need to guard against the spirit of distraction. Hallelujah. Regardless of where you fellowship, hallelujah, and what institution you belong to, the mandate is the same: to glorify God, to edify and equip the body of Christ, to win the lost at all costs, and to destroy the works of the enemy. There is a new generation emerging that is anti-God, a generation that is all-inclusive, and love darkness more than light. The distractions are many, and it is easy for the church to lose focus. But I want to encourage the body of Christ today to remain focused on your God-given assignment. We cannot allow the spirit of distraction to distract us from fulfilling our God-given assignment. The Apostle Paul, writing to the Corinthian church in 1 Corinthians 15 and 58, he says, "Brethren, be steadfast and unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord." We have to guard against the spirit of distraction. I think Nehemiah was guarding against the spirit of distraction. Yes, his friends Sambalat and Tobias was trying to distract the man of God from fulfilling his God-given assignment, but he remained focused. And I feel that the enemy is trying to distract us from fulfilling assignment, and we have to guard against the spirit of distraction in these times. Secondly, hallelujah, we need to guard against the spirit of discouragement. In these uncertain times, we can be certain of the faithfulness of Almighty God. The Bible tells us that God is not slack concerning his promises. Whatever he says, he is going to bring it to pass. Paul, writing to the Philippian church, Paul says, "He who has begun a good work in us is able to finish it." When we see all that is happening around us, as preachers, we could become very discouraged and begin to question ourselves. With the rise of false prophets and apostasy, hallelujah, my friend, we could be easily turned off and discouraged. And I could imagine Nehemiah hearing the voices of Sambalat and Tobias and the many others. "What are you all trying to do? What are you all trying to do? It will not work. It will not happen." And I could imagine the voices that he was hearing around him from people who seems to be, hallelujah, high up in society. But he remained encouraged. Brothers and sisters, we need to learn how to encourage ourselves in the Lord. We need to learn how to stand our ground and know that we know that we know that with God all things are possible. We need to take courage and rise in faith, believing that God is in control and that he is fighting for us, pushing back darkness in the name of Jesus Christ. In Romans 8:37, the Apostle Paul says, "Yea, in all these things we are more than conquerors through Christ that loves us." Brothers and sisters, discouragement is going to come. We are going to face it as we rise to build together. We are going to hear the negative voices. We are going to see people laughing and mocking and trying to ridicule the church of the living God. But united, we would stand. Hallelujah. We are a force to be reckoned with. And I want to encourage us today to guard against the spirit of encouragement. God is with us. In Isaiah 40 and verse 10, the prophet says, "Fear not, be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will uphold you with my right hand of righteousness." We need to take courage today and be encouraged that the God of Isaac, the God of Abraham, and the God of Jacob is with us. And because he lives, we are going to face our tomorrow. As we celebrate Pentecost 2022, let's guard against the spirit of discouragement. Let's be encouraged. Let's know who is on our side. The Lord Jehovah is with us. The Lord Jehovah is our God. He is fighting for us. I hear Zechariah says, "It's not by might, it's not by power, it's not by our feeble abilities or the wisdom of men, but it's by my spirit, says the Lord God Almighty. God is with us. Be not discouraged, pastors. Be not discouraged, members. Let's take courage and know that this battle belongs to the Lord. Romans 8 and 28, the Apostle Paul says, for this we know, that all things work together for good to them that love God and to those who are called according to his purpose. Let's guard against destruction. Let's guard against division. Third here today, we need to guard against the spirit of division. No church can survive in isolation. The more fragmented we are, the less impact we would have. No church is better than any church. We have all been given an assignment by God. The Bible says one of these days we would stand before God to give an account to all of us of the things we have done here on the earth. Mark 3:24 tells us, but the kingdom divided against itself shall never stand. Our battle is not against flesh and blood. The Apostle Paul, writing to the Ephesians church in chapter 6, he says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against spiritual wickedness in high places, against the rulers of darkness of this age. We have to guard against the spirit of division. According to the passage we would have read in Nehemiah 4 and verses 6, the entire chapter, the Bible says that the people had a mind to work. They were in one mission. They had one goal. They had one vision, and that was to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem, to rebuild the broken walls, to rebuild that which was broken, preventing security and safety to the people of God. It's time in the book of John, Jesus prayed that we be one. In Psalms 133, the Bible says, behold, how good and pleasant and lovely it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. As we build together, we have to guard against the spirit of division. Child of God, Satan wants to divide us. And if he divides us, then we would have no impact. But to God be the glory. We are so thankful for this team that we are working together to rebuild whatever that was broken in the name of Jesus Christ. Child of God, you hear me today. We have to guard against the spirit of division. The Bible says to mark them that create division among us and to avoid them. In the book of Proverbs, the wise man says, these 6 things the Lord hates, and the 7 is an abomination unto the Lord. He that soweth discord among the brethren. Child of God, God hates disunity. God hates it when we function fragmented, when we work against each other, when we pull down one another, when we refuse to restore and reconcile our relationship one with another. God hates disunity. God cannot move as he would like where there is division. That's why unity is so precious. And we have to fight for unity. We have to guard against the spirit of division as we strive to work together, as we strive to build together and restore all that was broken in the name of Jesus Christ. Unity is one of the most powerful forces we have and can use against the assignment of the enemy. Jesus himself prayed and he says, oh God, Father, I pray that they be one, even as you and I are one. Hallelujah. God believes in unity. When we unite, the powers of darkness cannot penetrate us. When we unite, the powers of darkness cannot defeat us. When we unite, there is no weak link. Hallelujah. We stand with each other. We support each other. We pray for one another. We forgive each other. We love one another. When we unite, there is power in the name of Jesus Christ. And even as we celebrate Pentecost 2022, I want to encourage us this midday hour to guard against the spirit of distraction. Whatever is coming our way, whatever is trying to hinder us from fulfilling our assignment, let's guard against it. Let's guard against the spirit of discouragement. Let's learn how to encourage ourselves in the Lord. Psalms 34, David says, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praises shall continually be in my mouth. My soul will make a boast in the Lord, and the humble will hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let's exalt his name together. For I sought the Lord, and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. You hear me? There are things happening around us that could discourage us, but we have to learn to square our shoulders and remind ourselves of who we are and who we belong to, and to remind ourselves that our God is still a champion. Our God is still a champion. Our God is still on the throne. And because he lives, we will face our tomorrow. Let not your heart be troubled. If you believe in God, John says, believe also in the Lord Jesus Christ. Child of God, this midday hour, I want to tell you, be encouraged. God is for us. God is with us. God is going to help us in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. To God be the glory. We have to guard against the spirit of division. I said also, don't allow anybody, don't allow anything. We can't allow our doctrines. We can't allow how we feel or the flesh to divide us as a spiritual institution. The world is in darkness, and the Bible says that we are the light of the world. We are still the salt of the earth, and we cannot allow the things around us to divide us as the body of Christ. Nehemiah faced those three things and more. He faced distractions. He faced discouragement. And even within the camp, he may have faced division. There may have been folks wondering, what is he doing? There may have been folks wondering, what is going on? But to God be the glory, he remained focused. And even as we celebrate Pentecost 2022, let us remain focused. For God did not give us a spirit of fear, but of love and of power and of a sound mind. We are overcomers. We are more than conquerors. The church of God was born in fire, and we refuse to live in smoke. The church of God is moving forward. The church of God is alive and well. Wherever you are across this world, wherever you are hearing my voice, let it be known this day that the church of God is alive and well. The Bible says, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, the Spirit of God came and breathed upon man. Child of God, we are encountering, we are living in one of the greatest era of our time, where we would see the manifestation of the power of Almighty God. We are going to see the glory of God return to our full gospel churches. We are going to see the presence of God operating again. We are going to see signs and wonders, because the Spirit of God will not fail. In the book of Joel, the Bible says, in the last days, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Child of God, we are in those days where God is about to restore everything the canker worm may have eaten, everything the palmer worm may have eaten. Tell the devil, look out, the church is on the rise. I did not say denomination, I did not say organization, I said the church, the ecclesia is on the rise. God will be glorified. God would be exalted. God would be magnified. I encourage you today, be not discouraged. Do not be distracted. Don't encourage division, but remain focused so that the power and the presence of God can indeed fill our nation. God bless you today. I pray, God, that something said would have encouraged your heart at this midday hour. Know that the God I'm talking about is the God who is omnipotent, omniscient, and omnipresent. The God who is forever faithful. The God who is a winner and will never lose a battle. I encourage you this midday hour. Arise and shine, for the glory of the Lord is upon us. Apostle Devine saying, let's rise and build together. Let's build back what is broken. Build back healthy friendships. Build back good relationships. Build back, hallelujah, the fear of Almighty God in our day and time. Have a wonderful lunch hour, and may God continue to prosper you. May God continue to enlarge your territory. And please be reminded that the giant in front of us is never bigger than the God inside of us. God bless you. Happy Pentecost 2022.
I will live, I will not die. The rest of us shall have a right.
Thank you very much, Dr. Devine, for such a powerful word of God. Thank you for whetting our appetite for even more. So now, coming to bring the word for us is Dr. James Davis. Let's open our hearts for what this man of God has for us today.
Today, I want to talk to you about Pentecost in your house, Pentecost in my house, Pentecost in God's house, and what that means to us as we move forward. We're not going back to normal. We're going forward to the Christ-given normal. It's not that Christ is pushing us from behind, but he's pulling us from the front to come to where he is today. The book of Acts is not the old-time religion. It's not the new-time religion, but it's the all-time religion. It is the anytime religion and the everytime religion and the now time religion. God doesn't want us to go back to then. He wants us to experience what he has for us today. We're not looking for a new normal. That's a compromise. We're looking for the Christ-given normal that he has for all of us. It's Pentecost. We're going to look at a very familiar and famous story. It's really the opening of the Gentile world to world evangelization. It's a critical and key moment in time. Chapters 8, 9, and 10 in the book of Acts make up a trilogy. They're like a trilogy of missiology. And if you never looked at it that way, I really want you to encourage you to go back and reread Acts 8, 9, and 10. because it is the Holy Spirit at work in a dynamic and living way among a deacon, a layman, and a preacher. And in Acts 10, we see the opening of the Gentile world. God arranges a blind date between two different individuals from two different streams of Christianity, from two different kinds of background, one Jewish, one Gentile, and God arranges this blind date and brings them together. He gives a vision to Peter on different occasions about what is pure, and he gives an angel to Cornelius to get these two guys together, and Peter comes and he shares his heart. I believe there are several Pentecostal witnesses that are for you and for me, and I trust and pray that God gets them down deep in our hearts and helps us to understand that what he has for us is real and vibrant and wonderful today. The first thing I pray the Holy Spirit lays upon your heart is that we have a personal witness of the saints. Now, I'm going to read a number of verses here, and you're going to see them on the screen. In Acts chapter 10, beginning in verse number 38 and going through verse 43, if you got a copy of God's Word there, I want to encourage you to open it up, put it in your lap, and follow along. Don't be distracted with other things in the home today. Let's focus right now in our moments together that it's Pentecost in your house today. We read in Acts chapter 10, verse 38, Peter begins his talk about how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses, underscore that phrase, we are witnesses of all things which he did both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, and whom they slew and hanged on a tree. Him God raised up on the third day and showed him openly, not only to the people, but unto witnesses, underscore that again, and unto the witnesses chosen by before God, even to us who did eat and drink with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach unto the people and to testify that he is which was ordained of God to be the judge of the quick and the dead. We have a personal witness of the saints. Peter says, and we are witnesses. Can you imagine a jury being pulled together from different streams of a community, cross-pollination of all, and you're trying to reach a verdict, a conclusion? Now, what the Lord has done in those early years is he's handpicked his Christ followers and he's pulled them together, and they have become witnesses. Now on your screen, you're going to see a summary of some of these apostles, and I'm going to give just a description a little bit along the way. When you think of John, he was a young man, he was a visionary, he was a sort of a philosopher type fellow. Simon Peter was the opposite of John, however. He was a big fisherman, hard-working fisherman. I imagine he had some salty language before he got saved. We know that because after he got saved, there was some cursing that he did. And so we know that was part of his nature. And we think of Simon the Zealot. The word Zealot is an extreme right winger. He was a political activist. He was a Zionist. He was pro-Israel. The opposite to him, however, was Matthew. Matthew the publican was a tax collector. He was sold out to the Roman government. Could you imagine American, you know, who became a tax collector for the Chinese or the Russians, because the Chinese or the Russians overtaken our nation. And as a result of it, they were collecting taxes for the Chinese or for the Russians or some other country. Could you imagine the difficulty we would have with such a man? Then there's Nathaniel. Nathaniel was a cynic. Remember, he was the one who said, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Then there was Thomas, we call the doubter. He said, unless I see the nail piercings, I won't believe. Then there was Philip, and he was a figure. He was an accountant kind of leader. He had a calculator in his head. He said, you know, it'll take so much money to feed these 5,000. And so there was James. See, James, who wrote the epistle that bears his name, was a businessman, no-nonsense man. Go read that book and you'll understand the kind of man that he was. Andrew was such of a nice guy, running around taking care of everybody. And these are some of the summary of the apostles. And yet all of these different men, different streams of their day, came to the same conclusion that Jesus is the Son of God. And what was their testimony? Well, it was about his virtuous life. Peter said, and how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power and went about doing good, healing all who are oppressed. They were witnesses to the miraculous of Jesus Christ. I can imagine Peter saying to Cornelius and the other men and women in that house, don't tell me that it wasn't true, because I saw it with my eyes. Don't tell me he didn't turn the water into wine. I tasted it. Don't tell me that he didn't walk on water. I walked on water with him. Don't tell me that he didn't raise that young girl from the dead. I was there and I talked to Jesus after it. Don't tell me that this is a fable. This is a fact. This is not secondhand knowledge. We saw him cast out devils. We saw him heal the sick. We saw him speak to nature and for it to be silent. We saw the miraculous. We saw his virtuous life. But not only his virtuous life, but secondly, his vicarious death. He says in verse 39, and you can see this verse on your screen, and we are witnesses of all things which he have done both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they slew and hanged on a tree. Peter says, hey, we were in the background. We saw them when they took the nails and put it through his quivering hands and feet. We saw him when they put the thorn on his head and the blood flowed down his face. We heard him cry out in anguish. We heard him say, God, forgive them. We heard him say, Lord, why have you forsaken me? We saw and heard and saw him breathe his last breath, give up the ghost, and die on that cruel Roman cross. We saw his vicarious death with our own eyes. We saw all that took place. We didn't just hear about it, we were there. And not only were we witnesses of these two, but we were witnesses of his victorious resurrection. In verses 40 and 41 of our same text in Acts chapter 10, we read these words, God raised him up the third day and showed him openly, not to all the people, but unto witnesses chosen before God, even to us who did eat and drink with him after he rose from the dead. Peter said, hey, we saw him after he was resurrected. We talked with him. We walked with him. We sat down. We ate with him. He showed up to us, and not only to us, but he showed up to 500 witnesses on one occasion. Can you imagine marching in 500 witnesses into a courtroom and they all declare the same thing? He is risen. He is alive. He is victorious over death. That is who Jesus was and is. And they testified of those great miracles. Can you imagine the courtroom and the conclusion of such a thing? You know, a lot of people may live a lie, but not a lot of people will die with a lie. A lot of people may do a lot of things with a lie, but they very seldom will give up their life for a lie. You know how these 11 died? They all died a martyr's death. Peter was hung upside down and in the city of Rome. And Paul was later beheaded because of his walk with the Lord. And so don't think for one skinny Pennsylvania second today that these men and women died because of a lie. They died because of the truth. And we are witnesses today of his life, of his death, and of his resurrection. He lives. How do we know he lives? He lives in our heart today. I remember like it was yesterday coming out of a psychology classroom. And at the University of South Alabama, was my early formative years in college. And I was coming out and I literally made a right and I was gonna walk through an open field. And the enemy was talking to my soul and said, what you believe about Jesus is not true. What you believe about salvation is not true. What you believe about the Holy Spirit is not accurate. And I spoke back at the enemy who was tempting my walk with the Lord. And I said, what you say is a lie. I know that he lives. I know that he saves. And I know it because I've experienced in my heart what those early New Testament Christians experienced. Now, I've been saved and I've been baptized in the Holy Spirit and I speak in tongues like they did. Don't say to me that it's not real. I know that it is real. And on this given Pentecost Sunday, ask God to give you a fresh Pentecost in your house today. The Holy Spirit is real. He's alive and well, and He's ministering throughout the earth today. We have a personal witness of the saints. But secondly, we have a prophetic witness of Scripture. Now I want you to listen to what verse 43 says of Acts 10, and you'll see it on the screen here. And he says, "To him give all the prophets witness, that through his name whosoever believeth in him shall receive the remission of sins." This verse gives us the key to the Old Testament. Notice what he says, "To him give all the prophets witness." Not some, but all of the prophets witness. Do you know what they're saying? They're saying that Jesus saves. Do you know what Peter was saying to Cornelius? Jesus is the Son of God and Jesus saves today. The Bible was not written just to give us an historic information about Israel and Jerusalem. No, no, no. The Bible was written to declare that Jesus is Messiah and He's the Savior of all of the world. When we open up our Bibles, Jesus Christ steps out of the pages of our Bible because it's a hymn book. It's a book about Him. From Genesis to Revelation, it is one hymn book. It's a book about Jesus Christ. When we look at Adam and Eve, the first animal that was slain to give them garments to clothe their naked, it talks about the redemption and blood of Jesus. When we look at Cain and Abel offered a more appropriate and respectful sacrifice, it spoke of Jesus one day as the Lamb of God. In Genesis 3:15, the Lord speaks to Eve and says, "You will step on the head of the serpent and he will break his back." He was talking about the redemption that was coming. In the book of Genesis, we read about Abraham and offering up Isaac. And it was a symbol, a picture of one day the father offering up his son. When we look in Exodus chapter 12 and we see the Passover, what a beautiful picture of Jesus being the Passover lamb. Because when you look at it, go back and reread it in chapter 12. They all take the blood and they put it up there on the doorpost. And then they all feast on the lamb. The angel comes over, the death angel comes over that night, and they're protected. And the next morning, they go out under the blood with the lamb on the inside. How do we get to heaven? We get to heaven under the blood with the lamb in the inside of us. What a beautiful picture that the Passover is about Jesus Christ. The scapegoat, they would be two goats, one pure, one impure. The one that was pure symbolized that Jesus Christ is the pure Lamb of God, and he would be offered as a remission of sins for the nation of Israel. And then the other was a scapegoat. They would lay their hands on the head of the goat, and then they would confess their sins upon the goat, and the goat would be sent out, symbolizing that Jesus Christ would bear all the sins of the world. And then we look about the morning dove or the turtle dove, the sadness of the dove. Jesus was the man of all sorrows. It pictured him. We think about the flour or the meal offering that was beaten and baked by the fire. It would be Jesus that would be beaten and he would walk through the corridors of the hot halls of hell for us and lead captivity captive and give us victory in his name. We think about the frankincense that which speaks of the intercessory prayer of Jesus Christ unto this day. God would say to the early Israelites, build a tabernacle. And on the outside of the tabernacle, it didn't look very expensive or very valuable. It looked very, actually, not quite attractive at all, but it was on the inside, the gold and silver and precious jewels. And same it is with Jesus on the outside. He looked like an ordinary man, a man of sorrows, but on the inside, oh wow, how phenomenal and powerful and precious he really is. When you walked inside the tabernacle, you saw the brazen altar, which spoke of Christ, his sacrifice. Then we saw the person came to the laver, which spoke of Christ and his sanctification. Then he went to the place of the showbread. Christ is our substance. And then you went to the candlestick, Christ our sight. Then you went to the altar of incense, Christ our supplication. And then you see him at the Christ and his sanctification as we go into the Holy of Holies. You know, that temple, that tabernacle had three doors. That one door took you to the outer court, another door took you into the holy place, another door where the veil was took you into the Holy of Holies. One person has said many years ago, the first heaven we see by day, the second heaven we see by night, the third heaven we see by faith. When you walked in through that tapestry, that veil, it was symbolic with stars embroidered on it. Symbolically, the high priest was walking through into the Holy of Holies. What did Jesus do? He left the first heaven, went up into the second heaven, went to the third heaven, went through the starry skies of glory, walked through the third door into the portals of God's glory, and he sits and he rules and reigns today. And when we look at the Bible, what it articulates in the Old Testament particularly is Jesus is the Son of God, and truly Jesus saves. When you read Psalm 2, talks about the rulers of the world bowing their knee at him, but before him. When you look at Psalm 22, it's like you're standing at the cross reading what is taking place right there before you. When you look in the book of Micah, you see that Jesus was born in Bethlehem. When you look at Isaiah 53, the masterful chapter of what Jesus Christ would do on the cross for us. When you look at Zechariah, that his hands and feet would be pierced. In Zechariah, it says he would be born in Bethlehem. And Malachi, it says that John the Baptist would come. All of the Old Testament was a prophetic witness of who Jesus Christ was and is. Could you imagine with me if you were given the assignment to paint a picture of a person that you never saw, and yet you were called upon to paint it perfectly? How could you imagine if you had 40 men that were given the same assignment from over a span of time to paint the same picture of a person they'd never met, and yet it had to perfectly represent them? Well, that's what the Old Testament is. The Old Testament is made up of 40 different men who wrote the Bible over 15, or Old Testament over a 1500 year period of time, and they all painted the same picture perfectly. It is a testimony of what the Bible is. It is a testimony of the harmony of Scripture. It's a testimony of the inspiration of the Word of God. Oh, my friend, what a joy and a privilege it is to know that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Everything you see in the Old Testament, it says that Jesus saves, and he saves to the uttermost. And what's amazing, when you look in, for example, in John's gospel, in John chapter 8, verse 56, you read these words, "Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad." The Bible says the gospel was preached to Abraham. He saw this day, he saw me, and he was glad. So on this day of Pentecost in our house, we have a personal witness of the saints. We have a prophetic witness of Scripture, but even better yet, we have a praise witness of the Spirit. I want you to look with me over in verse number 44 through verse number 48, these words. "While Peter yet spoke these words, the Holy Spirit fell on them which heard the word, and all and the circumcision believed and were astonished. And as many came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also were poured out the gift of the Holy Spirit, for they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God." The word magnify God means to praise God. "And then answered Peter, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized, which they have received the Holy Ghost as we have? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of Jesus. They prayed that they him to tarry certain days or several days. Peter gave witness that this was the first witness. Scripture gave the second witness, but the Holy Spirit gives the third witness. And the Holy Spirit witnesses today that Christ is in us, that Christ was the very Son of God. What happened? Cornelius and the people there immediately began to speak in other tongues. This was a sign gift. This was a sign gift because God was saying that the Gentiles now are offered in, are grafted in to the body of Christ, to the kingdom of God. It was the opening, the gateway of world evangelism. It happened in a man's house. It happened with a man's family. And I want to challenge all of us today to be a missions-minded house, to be a missions-minded family, to be a great commission leader and a great commission follower, and believe that the Holy Spirit wants to use us to win the lost, equip the saints for world evangelization. You see, my friend, it was a sign gift, but it was a sound gift. They heard them speak. They heard them speak with other tongues, and it was a significant gift. It was a wonderful, amazing work that God was saying, I'm doing something globally, not just locally. And God opened the floodgates and poured out the power of the Holy Spirit. And how did Peter know that these men were a part of the kingdom of God? Because they heard them speak with other tongues. It was vocalized and it was visualized. And you know, the Bible says in Acts chapter 2, verse number 39, Peter, standing up on the day of Pentecost, said these words. He pronounces a phenomenal message to them, and he says, this promise is for you and for your children, and as far and as many as the Lord shall call unto himself. He said, this promise is for you, for your children, and as many as the Lord shall call unto himself. You know, notice what he said, this promise. Mom, dad, son, daughter, brother, sister, grandmother, grandfather, this is a promise. You have to claim the promise. You have to take hold of the promise. The promise is for you. Not only is it a promise gift, but it's a present gift. He said this promise is for you. He doesn't say it was for you. Some say that this promise went out with the apostles. No, 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 no. This promise is for you, present tense. And then it's a personal gift. He said this promise is for you, plural, not singular. He looks at thousands of people and he says, this promise is for you, for you, for you, and for you. It's for everyone. And then it's a parental gift. This promise is for you and your children. Mom, dad, the Lord wants your children to experience the power of the Holy Spirit and to pray in the language of the Holy Spirit. But it's a providential gift. As many as the Lord our God shall call. Folks, he's still calling. He's still baptizing. He's still giving the power of men and women to magnify the Lord in the power of the Holy Spirit. You see, they praise the Lord in a heavenly language. And the God desires for that to happen in all of our lives today. Another verse I think about on this Pentecost Sunday is one over in John chapter 7, 38 and 39, where Jesus is bringing in an invitation and a crescendo. And he said, if anyone is thirsty, let him come unto me and drink. And he that believes on me, as the scripture has said, of his innermost being shall flow rivers of living water. He says, if anyone, are you an anyone today? He doesn't say if someone. He said, if anyone is thirsty, he opens the doors. He says, anyone is qualified. Sometimes people say, well, I'm just not qualified to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I don't walk just right. I don't always talk just right. I, you know, do some things I shouldn't do sometimes. And when I get all my life cleaned up and get all that together, then I'll ask the Lord to do that. Well, if you could do that all by yourself, then why would you need the power of the Holy Spirit in your life? You see, holiness is not the way to Christ. Christ is the way to holiness. And Christ wants to empower all of us with the mighty power of the Holy Spirit. He says, if anyone is thirsty, are you thirsty? Are you thirsty on this day? He's not asking, were you thirsty before the pandemic of fear we call the coronavirus? He's saying, are you thirsty today? I don't know how much of the Lord you have, but you have just as much as you want. You know, my car has been empty many times, but my car has never been thirsty one time. I hear a lot of Christians say, well, I'm just so empty inside. The Lord is not asking, are you empty? He's asking, are you thirsty? If you're thirsty, He'll take care of your emptiness. I don't know how much you have, but you have all you want. But we're not talking about where